Hello, everybody. Christopher DiPiazza here again with another paleo art live stream demonstration with Field Station Dinosaurs. As always, we put up to a vote every week between two different prehistoric animals, and today the winner was the most popular armored dinosaur, and that is Ankylosaurus, or Ankylosaurus. Some people pronounce it differently. Doesn't really matter, actually. Fun fact, I hear professionals pronounce it either way. I usually call it Ankylosaurus, though. And Ankylosaurus is actually the first ankylosaur that we've done so far. We've done Stegosaurus, which is another kind of armored dinosaur. We call it the major group of armored dinosaurs. We call the Thyrophorians. But this is the first one from the ankylosaur group that we've done, so that's cool. Ankylosaurus is definitely the most popular of all the ankylosaurs, and it's the most like iconic name. But that being said, it's not the most well understood of all the ankylosaurs. We actually don't have a whole lot of material from this dinosaur. We have good material, but not as much as we do of some other of its relatives. And because of that, a lot of the reconstructions that you see of ankylosaurus are actually based on other kinds of armored dinosaurs. So, for instance, this model's pretty good, and it's still old. It's still a bit outdated, but it's pretty good in the sense that you don't see any like big spikes on this dinosaur's body. So many ankylosaur toys, even ones made right long after this one, have these big spikes sticking out of the sides. Like the ones from Jurassic Park and Jurassic World have this. They have like a very uniformly armored back with big spikes lining the sides. That's very much outdated. We don't think this animal looked like that. There's other ankylosaurs out there that were spikier, and I think for a long time scientists didn't really know exactly how the arrangement of the armor on this dinosaur looked, so they kind of used it, borrowed arrangements of other ankylosaurs and applied it to it. So things like if you know your dinosaurs, there's a dinosaur called Eoplacephalus, which is very closely related to Ankylosaurus. A lot of Ankylosaurus reconstructions and toys are actually really Eoplacephalus toys, but they call them Ankylosaurus. So it's known for having all this armor on the back. The armor actually was lightweight and strong. The tail also had a big club on the end of it, and like the rest of the armor, the way the tail club was, or actually, I shouldn't say how it was made, but what it was made of was a hard outer layer of very dense, hard bone. But the inside of the club was a much spongier kind of bone. So it was still very hard and would have been very powerful to swing around, but it wouldn't have been too heavy for the dinosaur to hold up in the air. The tip of the tail, about right here, was reinforced by like ossified tendons. So these are basically like rods of bone that stiffened the end of the tail, which meant that to help support this club piece. Okay, so the club weapon that this dinosaur had was supported by the last part of the tail, otherwise it would just kind of be bending and drooping down all the time. Wouldn't be really good for the dinosaur. The base of the tail had huge muscles. In fact, this toy could afford to have probably bigger, wider muscles here. That would have attached directly from the leg to the base of the tail to help swing it around. Ankylosaurus, a lot of times, like cartoons and stuff, they show it like swinging the tail all different directions. It was really ideally built for swinging it in a side-to-side motion, which is perfect level to hit a big meat-eating dinosaur like Tyrannosaurus in the shins. So that would have been a very effective weapon. As for the rest of the armor, I did touch on it a little bit before. It was lightweight. It was made of bone. Okay, so this arm, these bones, these are bones. These little white pieces on the toy here, but they weren't attached to the skeleton. So you had the dinosaur's actual skeleton, like everybody, like we have, but on top of it, like kind of embedded into the skin, on top of the muscle, you know, kind of floating in the soft tissue, were these chunks of bone that would have helped armor the dinosaur. And it wasn't just dinosaurs like Ankylosaurus that have this stuff. We call it osteoderms. Other dinosaurs had stuff like this going on. There's some sauropods which actually had osteoderm armor, not as intense as Ankylosaurus, but they had it. And also, some reptiles that are alive today, like crocodiles and alligators, have osteoderms. So they have a skeleton, but on their backs, they have little chunks of bone that forms like an armor, like a kind of like wearing chainmail. So let's get to it. Let's start drawing this guy. So Ankylosaurus is a really, really unusual animal. I mean, it's ankylosaurs in general are just weird. The fact that they evolved the way they did is pretty miraculous. So I'm going to start by doing some basic shapes like I usually do. So the head is going to be over here. The torso is going to be here. The back leg is going to be here. The tail is going to be there. So there's our basic shape. Now, again, don't forget, I have to finish this by 4 o'clock. Sorry, by 5 o'clock my time, so I only have an hour. So if you think I'm going too fast, that's okay. Just keep in mind this is going to be available for everybody to watch as much as they like on YouTube. So if you get left behind or if you can't keep up, that's all right. I do need to finish it in a certain amount of time. So you could just always go back to that YouTube video, and finish up that way. Lyndon wants to know if they were herd animals. As far as I know, we don't have any evidence suggesting that any ankylosaur, let alone Ankylosaurus itself, would have lived in herds. I don't think we've ever found a group of adults. I think there's a group of juveniles that they found together of an ankylosaur, but don't quote me on that. But as far as I know, there's never been like a group, like a bone bed of adult ankylosaurs found living together. And even when you do find bone beds of multiple animals, that doesn't necessarily mean that they were herd animals either. It just means that they happen to be in the same place, right? So there's other animals that we can observe alive today that do spend time in big groups, but they're not like herding animals. So, for instance, like grizzly bears, right? When grizzly bears are normally solitary, they hate being around other grizzly bears. They're actually really violent towards each other. It doesn't matter if it's a male or a female or what. The only time you're ever going to see a grizzly bear wanting to be around other grizzlies is if it's a mother with her cubs. But normally, they don't hang around each other except when there's salmon coming up to spawn. Then there's enough food in one area where you'll actually see like 100 grizzly bears all together. But they're not there because they're a group. They're there because all of the food is in the same place. Okay. An example of a dinosaur that's alive today, that is a bald eagle. Okay. Bald eagles, another example. They will congregate in big groups together if there's a food source, but they are not social. They don't really want to be together. And if they do invade each other's personal space, they will fight. But sometimes you will see them together. So even we really have, it's very, very difficult to prove that any fossil animal, dinosaur or not, was truly a herd animal. Very difficult to prove. Even if you find a group of them together, it's hard to really tack that onto them. Just something to keep in mind. Doesn't mean that they weren't, just that we can't really say one way or another. All right. So Ankylosaurus's head is very interesting. It's unique. And it's an odd shape. So I kind of drew this dinosaur in like a 45 degree angle, and you could do the best to follow along, and I'll break it down for you in kind of shapes. So Ankylosaurus's mouth kind of came down to like a beak, and it was relatively wide. So I'm going to kind of draw like a shallow U shape for like the tip of the beak there. And then the lower jaw kind of went like that. And then where like the cheekbone is, and we have cheekbones too. That kind of extended outward into like a big triangular horn. And ceratopsians have stuff like this too, the horn dinosaurs like Triceratops. And that kind of would have stuck out there. And then the eye socket would have been about here. And then there would have been another horn that would have come out here. It's like almost like the same shape, and it would have been kind of like symmetrical, like a mirror image top to bottom of this jugal horn, we'll call it. So if you want to look at the toy, the model, you can see it. If you look directly at him, it kind of looks like he has like a star-shaped face, right? So there's the horns coming out here, and then there's also the horns coming out here, kind of, a little bit be above and behind the eye. So that's kind of like the basic shape. The eye itself would have been very small. And I don't know if you guys knew this, a lot of books like to talk about this. Ankylosaurus's eye sockets were actually armored. So even their eyelids, the piece of skin that we have that goes over our eye when it closes it, their eyelids actually even had a little piece of bone on them. It's pretty cool. So even their eyelids were armored. All right. So I'm going to kind of redraw that triangle, and then I'm going to draw like another like skinnier triangle on top of it, and that kind of gives it the three-dimensional look here. And then the top of the snout is going to be here, and then there's going to be another horn coming out from that way. And the nostril of these guys was also really oddly placed. You can see it kind of on the toy here. It's like kind of like low, right above the mouth, not where you'd expect the nostril to be. So this piece all here, there was no nostrils here. This is all like just bone. The nostril was like down here. The little like line there I put there. You could see it there. Little tiny line. Okay, and then the lower jaw would have been here. And again, Ankylosaurus's mouth was very beak-like. It was like a big beak. Some more armor down there. Okay. Now, on the neck, Ankylosaurus had other armor. I'm gonna kind of go through and just draw this armor, and it was more or less kind of like a soft rectangular shape. There would have been another one right behind it. And then there would have been another big piece that kind of had a little blob on the bottom, right over where the shoulders would have been. And draw a line there. There's another piece of armor there. Another one here. I'm going to skip ahead, go to the hips. And I'm going to draw kind of like, imagine if you took like a piece of like aluminum foil, like a bigger rectangle shaped piece of aluminum foil, and you kind of just laid it over the hips here. So Ankylosaurus, at least the group of ankylosaurs that Ankylosaurus belongs to, had a big sheet of bone that actually went right overneath the pelvis. So before I told you they had osteoderms that were kind of floating around in the skin, but over the pelvis there was just kind of like a big plate of bone that had little knobs on it here. We call a sacral shield. Sacral means it references the hips, the pelvis. So we call this a sacral shield. So I'm going to imply a little bit that that was there. And it was lined with some smaller little pieces of bone. Ankylosaurus, if you haven't figured out already, it's kind of a complicated and tedious dinosaur to draw. There's some little bones here. I'm just going to draw some little knobs sticking up. Row of like little smaller bony pieces of armor leading up to that. Finish the back here. There we go. And then going down the tail, it's very much likely, going off of other ankylosaur relatives, that there was a row of little bones, pieces of armor that were on either side of the tail. So I'm just going to kind of indicate that here. And then on the top, there's another row. And then on the other side of the animal, which we can't fully see, it would have been similar, but you can't really see those. Now, Ankylosaurus's tail, if you look at, we actually have the tail itself. It's kind of a funny looking shape. It's like kind of divided into segments. There's two big segments here and here. And then there's two like smaller segments here and here. It almost kind of looks like a bug's head with the paint job on this toy here. It's kind of silly looking. So we're kind of drawing ours from the side. So I'm gonna draw the one of the big segments here. And then the smaller segments are going to kind of be implied behind it. There's a lot of work with what we call perspectives in this drawing, which is something that does take a lot of practice. All right, so there's the armor and the tail of our Ankylosaurus pretty much so far. Now I'll move on to the arms and the legs. So Ankylosaurus's arm is going to be here. This guy or girl would have had very powerful limbs. Need to be able to lift itself up. It was, even though the armor was lightweight for what it was still a relatively heavy animal. I'm going to give it one, two, three claws, not more than that. Dinosaurs didn't have more than three claws on their front limbs. They could have more than three fingers on their front limbs, but not more than three claws. So some dinosaurs have five fingers, but only digits one, two, and three actually have claws. The other two fingers don't have any. And this is actually a common trait across the board, not just for dinosaurs, but for the group of reptiles they belong to called the archosaurs. So other examples of archosaurs would be pterosaurs, are also a kind of archosaur. And crocodiles and alligators, they're also archosaurs. So if you ever go to the zoo, look at the alligators or the crocodiles, if you get a good look at their hands, you'll see they have claws on one, two, and three, but not four and five. All right, now ankylosaurs in general, and this toy doesn't reflect it, had very wide bodies. This one was made with a not very wide body. But we know, thanks to some really well-preserved specimens of close relatives of Ankylosaurus, that their body was really wide. If you would have looked straight at one, that you would have seen the belly or the ribs, the midsection, sticking out on either side of the animal. So we're not drawing it head-on, but I'm still going to imply that its midsection was quite wide. It doesn't mean that the animal's like fat or anything, although they probably did have some fat on them, like everybody does. They just had really wide set ribs. So I'm going to kind of draw like this big kind of barrel shape with these curved lines to imply that the midsection of this dinosaur is quite wide. There are some ankylosaurs out there that are even wider than that, proportionally speaking, but still, Ankylosaurus would have been pretty wide. Here's the knee. Here's the leg or the shin. Here's one toe, two toe, and three toes. One toe, two toe, and the third toe would not be visible from that angle. And again, remember, when we're drawing the back leg and the tail, I'm not going to draw the back side of the thigh because there's a big muscle here. So it kind of would have just blended right into the tail. Could draw some curved lines here implying that there's like a rounded shape, but that's about it. Okay. So, think that's good for our Ankylosaurus drawing. I'm going to go in with my eraser now. I'm just going to kind of get rid of any of the extra lines that I have here. we go. Getting rid of some of these extra little sketchy lines that I did here. I did a lot of them this time. And also, it's a little tedious to go in between all this armor that I drew. But that's okay. I can go back and redraw that armor too. Not a big deal. Okay. Redraw the beak. Nostrils gonna be like kind of like there. All right. Nice. I think that looks pretty good, don't you? So I don't know. Is this how you thought Ankylosaurus looked? A lot of people have a misunderstanding of how Ankylosaurus looks. A lot of people think it was much spikier looking. It wasn't. Other ankylosaurs were quite spiky, but not this guy. Oh, so Lyndon wants to know about the. There's a recent paper that just came out, and they found an egg, a fossilized egg that's like that implies that when it was alive, the shell was soft. And when you think of an egg, usually you think of like a hard shell, like a chicken egg. But a lot of reptiles, and birds do count as reptiles technically, that lay eggs with shells have soft shells. I actually have something like that here. I wasn't actually planning on this, but I happen to have one. So as you might know, I have a lot of pet reptiles. And one of my pets is a gecko. She's called a gargoyle gecko, and she actually lays eggs all the time, just like a chicken does. So they're not fertilized. They're not going to hatch into little baby geckos. But just like chickens sometimes just lay eggs on their own that don't hatch, they're just eggs, so do other kinds of reptiles. So this is one of her eggs. Now it's dried out, but you can see it's kind of like wrinkly and folded in. It's not like perfectly smooth like a chicken egg. That's because when she first laid it, it was soft. It almost felt like leathery, a little squishy. Well, they found a fossilized egg that was very similar to this one. And what they think might have happened, originally they thought it was from a sea animal, like a mosasaur. But we have a lot of evidence that suggests that mosasaurs didn't even lay eggs. They couldn't, their bodies suggest that they couldn't even go on land if they wanted to. Not even like a sea turtle could. So it's likely that they actually gave birth to like live young, kind of like sharks might, or some reviprids. We call them oviviparous, which means that the mother has the eggs, but she doesn't lay them. She keeps them inside her body, and then the babies hatch, and they just come right out of her body. So some reptiles today do that, like boa constrictors, rattlesnakes do that. Okay, but so it was unlikely it was a mosasaur egg. So. It was found out recently that some dinosaurs actually laid eggs that were soft, not hard like a chicken egg. Only certain dinosaurs laid eggs like that. I think the sauropods did, like the long neck ones had hard shelled eggs. And some of the theropods, like the bird-like meat-eating dinosaurs, like Velociraptor and Oviraptor, would have laid eggs that were hard shelled. But a lot of dinosaurs, like the ceratopsians and things like that, might have laid eggs like this. So that egg might have been that. There's a lot we still don't know. It's exciting though, either way. I hope that answers your question. All right. Oh, and I almost forgot. So I actually have another toy to show you a comparison. So I mentioned that a lot of people think Ankylosaurus was spikier than it really was. This might look more like an Ankylosaurus to some of you, but this is an Ankylosaurus. This is called Eoplacephalus. So this is a more completely known dinosaur. We have a lot more fossils of this dinosaur. And you can see how spiky it is. It has a club as well. So these two dinosaurs were cousins, but this one is more completely known. So for a long time, when artists were trying to draw this one, which was discovered first and was bigger, they didn't have all the pieces, so they filled them in with this one, which leads us to a lot of reconstructions that look like this, but they're called ankylosaurs. So I hope that clears up some confusion for you. All right. So I think we're ready for some paint. So let's put our painting flat on the desk. That. And I'll angle the camera like this so you can see better. Here's my brushes, here's my water, and remember, I use watercolor, but you can use whatever you like to color it in. So you can use pencils, you can use crayons, you could use markers, you can use a different kind of paint, any of that's fine. All right. So, Ankylosaurus. This is a big animal. So I'm going to mix some black. And remember, you don't have to do yours the same color as mine if you don't want to. That's fine. Some black together with some little bit of blue. And maybe a little bit of this like reddish to make like a grayish purple. And I'm going to start by just filling in a basic kind of wash over the top part of the animal. So I'm going to leave the eye white because I'll do that later. Do the beak here. I'm going to actually leave the lower part of the animal white. What's really cool, someone has asked in the past, do we know what color any dinosaurs were? And the answer to the most of that question is no. Most dinosaurs, we have no clue what colors they were in life, but a few of them we do. And one of them happens to be a close relative of Ankylosaurus. Not Ankylosaurus itself. Its name is Boreal pelta. And Boreal pelta was another animal in the general Ankylosaur family. It didn't have a club on its tail, though. And it was discovered, and it was really beautifully preserved. And it was so well preserved that scientists could actually look at its skin, which preserved, the skin fossilized, under a microscope and tell what kind of pigments, which is a more scientific word for color, when it comes to nature at least, that skin was. And what they found out was that Boreal pelta was darker on top and lighter on the bottom. And it was likely like a reddish brown. Or just a brown, darker on top and lighter on the bottom. So I'm doing my Ankylosaurus a little bit more gray, but I'm still gonna maybe do a little nod to the fact that its relative was lighter on the bottom by keeping the bottom more whitish. But you don't have to do that. Just because a relative of an animal is a certain color doesn't mean another animal isn't a different color, right? Think about it. Like, for instance, lions and tigers are very closely related. They're so closely related, they're in the same genus, and they can even breed and have babies with each other. So if lions and tigers were named like dinosaurs, and we only refer to them by their genus name, they'd actually have the same name. So that's how closely related they are. We wouldn't really consider them, a lot of people would forget that they were different species if we treated them like prehistoric dinosaurs. So, but we all know that they look very different, right? They're different colors, their fur is different, right? So just because you have proof of certain colors on one member of a group doesn't mean all the members reflected that exact same thing. So I'm not going to do my Ankylosaurus exactly the same color as Boreal pelta, or what people think Boreal pelta was. There's still a little bit of room for variation. It might have had some other colors in addition to that brown, dark on top, light on the bottom that we don't know about. Because not all the pigment preserves, only some of it does. So even so, a lot of artists draw it or paint it brown, but it might have had other colors too. But I'm doing this Ankylosaurus like a grayish bluish purple. All right, gonna fill in these back legs here. Okay. Here it is. Very neat so far. And then I think we're going to go in and do a little bit more detailing. So let's make the armor stand out a little bit. So we can do that by now the toy, both actually the Ankylosaurus and the Eoplocephalus toys that I have the armor plates as like a little bit of a different color, lighter color. I'll do the opposite. I'll make the bony armor chunks a little bit of a darker color. So I'm actually with watercolor, that's actually easy to do. All I'm going to do is I'm going to take the same color, I'm just going to layer it on top. And I'll start with the beak here. Now, Ankylosaurus's entire top of the head was covered in these armor, these little osteoderms. And they were almost fused together to form like a few big forms. Here's that triangular cheek horn. And here's another chunk of armor on the bottom of the mouth there. Here's the lower part of the beak. Here's the neck armor. These like bands that kind of like a half ring shape that wrapped around the top of the animal's neck. If you notice, ankylosaurs in general didn't really have, they had a lot of armor on the top, but they had like no armor on the bottom. But they were also very low to the ground, right? So they weren't like tall dinosaurs. Their center of gravity was low. So it would have been very difficult even for like a T-Rex to, or a predator, which would have been at the same time as Ankylosaurus, by the way. So I'm using T-Rex as an example, to like flip an Ankylosaurus over. People say, oh, well, if you flip it over, it's defenseless. Yeah, but that's assuming you can flip it over. Ankylosaurus would have been so low to the ground, it would have been pretty heavy. It would have been very difficult for something like a Tyrannosaurus Rex to just flip it over. Wouldn't have been that easy. Especially considering it had like small arms. The T-Rex wasn't really like equipped to just do that. It's more equipped to just bite and crunch things. It's very likely that even though Tyrannosaurus Rex and Ankylosaurus lived at the same place at the same time, I highly doubt that Tyrannosaurus Rex hunted Ankylosaurus regularly. I'm sure once in a while it ate an Ankylosaurus, but I don't think it was a normal occurrence back then. Kind of like if you look at animals alive today, like lions, for instance, okay, live at the same time and place as elephants. But they don't often hunt elephants. They've hunted elephants, it's happened. And in some places, it happens more often than others. But elephants aren't a normal, regular part of a lion's diet, even though they live at the same time, because elephants are really well protected. They're big. All right, so there's the armor pieces, and I did the tail too, in this darker color. So that's pretty cool. And then let's move on to our little toenails. It's like a running inside joke here that we're gonna paint. I should run a nail salon for dinosaurs. So that's how I feel sometimes when I'm doing these little toenails. There we go. How beautiful. Very nice. And now I'll take this little paintbrush here and I'll do Ankylosaurus's eye. Do like a dark red for the eye. That looks pretty cool. There we go. We'll add a little pupil in there later. All right. Now, let's see. Oh, let's get working on the background now. So I think this ankylosaur should be in a nice kind of like a lush greenish habitat to, and that'll contrast nicely with the gray of the animal's body. Now, if you did your ankylosaurus in a different color, that's cool too. You can do a different background if you want. You don't have to copy my background. That's totally not required. So I'm going to start over here behind the foot. And start painting in some like little bushes and stuff. And I'm going to do that simply by just painting some squiggly lines because the background is going to have less detail than the foreground where the animal's standing. So I'm just going to start by filling in all these little bushes here. And as I'm doing it, I'm just making like messy motions with my paintbrush. And as the paint gets layered on top and dries, it makes this really neat, messy effect, but it could look like leaves on a bush, right? Instead of painting every single individual leaf, which would take forever, I can do this little trick with my brush and paint a whole bush in a matter of seconds. And you guys can experiment with that on your own. Do all kinds of cool stuff with that. Right, some more little bushes up here sticking out above the ankylosaurus. There we go. Underneath the animal's feet. behind its body. There we go. I'll do this part over here underneath the neck. All right, and don't forget, now is a great time to just voice your opinion on what dinosaur you'd like to see me paint next. So feel free to list that in the comments for next week. Someone just reminded me. So Crystal just mentioned that she can't wait for next week. Well, next week you guys can choose. Oh yeah, so just so you guys know, July 15th will not well is the only time in the foreseeable future that we won't be having an art lesson because I'm going to be away. But other than that, so next time. Next week. Alrighty. Still going with the bushes. A couple sticking above his little head here. On the neck, over the neck. Now remember, these bushes aren't actually over the dinosaur, they're behind it. But that's how we gotta paint it. Alright. So someone said T-Rex. T-Rex was the first dinosaur we did. So if you go to the YouTube channel, this was many weeks ago at this point, you'll see the T-Rex video is right there. So we want to do dinosaurs that we haven't done yet. And that's fine. Maybe you weren't here for that. That's okay. Pteranodon, we have not done yet. Pteranodon's been in the running a couple times already. So maybe we could put that one up again. So yeah, feel free. And don't be afraid to list one if you think it's already been done and you just didn't see it. That's okay. I'm happy to just let you know. And that way you can go watch it on your own on the YouTube channel. So if I remember correctly, a Pteranodon we have not done. So that's still a possibility. I'm trying to think. We've also had, I think, Dilophosaurus in the running, but it's never actually been done yet. So a few people have requested that one. Think Compsognathus was in the running one time against Troodon. Or it wasn't really true. Well, technically, it was Stenonicosaurus, but we called it Troodon. Here we go. All right, and I'm just painting the ground underneath Ankylosaurus here. And I'm not painting the whole picture. I'm not going crazy. I'm just kind of centering it around this little area here. All right, so I'll show you what I have so far. Pretty cool. So I have the bushes behind it. I have the ground underneath it. Now I'll go for the sky. If you remember my little trick for the painting the sky, is I just take blue and I just kind of imply that there's clouds by like painting the space in between the clouds. Go. Some little blue cloud space underneath the tail, or behind the tail, I should say. All right. Looking good. I'm gonna just clear that up with the water on the brush. That looks cool. Look how pretty that is. Very nice. All right. Let's see. Now, I'm going to go back to my pencil, and I'm going to shade this. I didn't shade it before. I usually shade it before the paint. I guess I forgot. So, let's see. I'm going to go in. I'm going to shade the under part of this triangle piece here. And that actually would have cast a shadow over the whole eye, like a triangle shadow. So I'm just going to fill that in there. There's going to be a shadow from the top part of the beak onto the lower part of the beak. And this horn here would cast a shadow onto the animal's neck and the lower jaw. There's a shadow underneath the neck that goes into the chest. And then there's going to be some like wrinkles here. And there's going to be a shadow on the underside of the arm. It's going to get lighter as we go down towards the hand. And then, of course, I'm going to go back in and highlight these little wrinkles around the eye. And there's going to also be some wrinkles around the nostril. Now, what I'm doing is I'm kind of filling in some lines on the top of the snout. And I'm just drawing some shapes. And these shapes are based on the actual skull. So the skull had all these little bones that kind of were fit together like puzzle pieces that were fused together to form like one big unit. And that's what I'm doing here. And if you go online, you could find, and mine, I'm doing the best I can from memory. But if you go online and you type in Ankylosaurus skull, there are pictures of the actual skull. And you can see all the little pieces of bone that would have fused together to form the top of the skull that would have been armored, which is pretty cool. All right. Now, there's a keel here on this bone here. That's why I do that line. So I'm going to shade the under part. Same thing here. So you could see on the toy. These bones had like a keel. We call it like a ridge. So when you're looking at it from the side, there's a shadow on the underside of them. So I'm doing that now. Doing these on the edge of that sacral shield that we talked about. Remember, that's a cool term that you can use when you're talking about dinosaurs, Ankylosaurus, and other ankylosaurs like Eupocephalus had sacral shields. It's that big sheet of bone over the hips. So a big question is why would these dinosaurs have had so much armor, right? Like, it's a lot. Well, one very common explanation for this armor is it would have helped defend them from predators. So in the case of Ankylosaurus, predators like Tyrannosaurus Rex, since that's the big meat-eating dinosaur that it lived alongside. And that's probably true. I'm sure if a Tyrannosaurus Rex tried to attack an Ankylosaurus, it would have definitely defended itself with its armor and its tail. But that may not have been the only reason why they had it. Another reason why Ankylosaurus might have had all this armor is to protect itself from other members of its own species. So Ankylosaurus may have engaged in some kind of combat with members of its own species for like dominance and stuff. And if you look at animals that do that, that kind of combat takes place a lot more frequently than them getting attacked by a predator. If you think about it, if you're an Ankylosaurus living in the late Cretaceous, North America, you would probably not be attacked by a Tyrannosaurus Rex every day. In fact, you might only be attacked by a Tyrannosaurus Rex maybe a few times in your whole life, if at all. But if you're in a if especially when you became an adult, you very likely would engage in some kind of combat or competition with members of your own species, whether it be for space, for food, maybe even for finding a mate. Maybe males fought each other for attention from females. Maybe females fought each other. We don't know. But try to remember, defense against predators isn't the only reason why animals develop certain adaptations. It's a quick go-to answer, and it may have been true, but it's not the only answer. All right. I'll do a couple circles in there. All right, there's our Ankylosaurus with the shading in. Here it is with the shading. Looks pretty cool. And now I can move on to the inking part, the black little fine tip marker that I use to go over the dinosaur itself that really makes it pop. So I'm gonna grab that here, and I'm gonna start on the eye. So the first thing I'm gonna do is the pupil. Now, since this eye is under a shadow, I'm not gonna do the reflection yet, or at all, because the eye itself isn't in the light, it's under a shadow from the horn. So I don't have to worry about that. All right, now we're gonna do the beak. It goes up into the horn here. The side horn. Top of the head. Lower jaw. Neck, some like wrinkles in the neck there, the chest, the forearm, the elbow, the belly, the side, and I remember I'm doing these lines to imply that it's much wider. The back foot, and the knee, the other back foot that's closer to us. Base of the tail and the club. All right, now we're going to go into the armor here. There's the sacral shield, and I'm doing these little bumps that imply there's armor there too without actually drawing every individual piece. Some wrinkles around the thigh, the little armor bits on the back of the tail, the top of the tail rather. There we go. And the nostril would be down here somewhere. Might even be completely visible. And the last step I almost forgot is to do the shadow underneath the Ankylosaurus, which would be in like a darker color. So I've mixed some black and blue and a little bit of that same brown together. And then I'm going to make sure my shadow is nice and wide to imply that the dinosaur itself is wide. Because it was. There we go. The last step, of course, is to sign my name. There we go. All right. So, here you go. Here's our finished Ankylosaurus, looking good. So, I hope you enjoyed our latest session, our paleo art session with Ankylosaurus, a popular armored dinosaur with the club on its tail. As always, please comment in the comment section of which dinosaur you would like or other prehistoric animal you would like us to do next time. And remember, July 15th, we're actually going to be putting it on hold for just one day, and we'll start right up again the week after for our paleo art session. Did we do a Therizinosaurus? We have not. Maybe we can put that one up there. We'll see. So, yep, I hope you guys all enjoyed yourself, and I will see you next time.